see if you're doing it right. This is a little longer, so. And then you notice, this thing works really well, but I think after a while it gets really nasty and dirty, and then you have to put on a new one. And that's your right hand, so yeah, you. Hey, your right hand looks like my left hand. Yeah. Okay. That's good. Okay, do the other. Oh, your left hand should be better.
Well, I use a. My right arm is actually. So.
What? They force you to use your right hand more when you're younger? So.
I don't know. I right, left hand, but I kind of am ambidextrous. I guess I've been watching other people do it so much.
Okay, now let's go the opposite way. It goes away from you. Just remember, okay, when you do it, okay, the regular way is always going, coming towards you, the other one is going away from you. That's how you can tell the difference.
I don't think we ever did though.
Yeah, I showed you. Forward and back, yeah.
This is forward.
Yeah, that's forward. Then you go, yeah. Okay, now the thing is, it comes. See, there you go. There you go.
Okay, so this one's got to go to this side. Yeah.
Yeah, there you go. You were only doing, okay, well, keep it, I thought I showed you both, but the thing is if you haven't learned both, just do the forward and backward. No, I had to teach you the backward, because you have to go back, because you're going to go back and forth. Okay.
Well, yeah, I remember you were showing me this one a long time ago.
Okay, yeah, that's the basic, just basic strike. Okay.
Yeah, right.
Well, okay, and as long as you're getting the right idea, let's see. Okay, you're actually not going back. You have to go side to side. You're only going one side, and you're getting your hand twisted up. Yeah, the left is a little bit, well, even for me, I'm a little surprised it's difficult for you, but. Someone left a bunch of frying pans and stuff there. Yeah. Okay. So the thing is when you go, this is the right. Okay, the right hand, like I showed you. Okay, right hand. And you go side to side. When you switch, okay, then all you do is just turn it. Okay? So when you're doing this one, okay, here, when you have it out this way, you can do it two ways. You can actually, once you have it out here, let's call this 3 o'clock. Okay, this 3, that'd be 9, 12, and 6. So the thing is, you just switch over and then come back this way. Okay? So every time, this is your starting position, so then you just bring it towards you. And that would be reverse. Okay? You bring it towards you. So from here, bring it towards you. This is one of the easiest ways to learn it, is actually using this idea of having the hand here. No. And then the thing is if you want to go forward, then, okay, instead of going forward towards you, the thing is you go downward. If you go downward, then you have the other way, okay? Now, you have the natural way that's here, that's going forward, okay? Then you stop, and then you reverse. Use this as your starting point. Okay, you can also, well, we do a different way, but I found out that this may be a better way than the way I learned it. The way I learned it is from here, from this position. I'm not sure, because then this one either goes down or it goes forward. Okay, see, I go forward and then I'm this way. Okay, and then I come back and this backward. But I like this way better, because then the thing is, you can actually see the difference. See if you, what you feel is the difference. Because I saw this and I said, I think that's a better idea. You know, because a lot of different styles start different ways. How's that work for you?
Well, this is like the first screen of the
Chicago. Yeah, yeah.
It starts out like that. Boom, it's a block across.
Yeah, no, but that's what I'm saying. I think that's a better way of showing how to do that, you know. See, okay, you have to understand, everything I learned was classically. That's how, you know, that's how they learned in China, and that's how they were taught here in the United States. So you start off with the stick right out here. Okay? See, and then you go forward, you know, because your hand, you want your hand to be out here. But if you did it the other way, you can actually know which is forward and which is backward. You know? See, if you start off this way, it's neutral. It's neutral. This way, you already know you can actually position yourself backward or forward.
So
it's a slight difference. It's a subtle difference, but it, to learn it.
Is this mainly a wrist movement or a forearm movement?
Okay, both. Okay, at the beginning, okay, you're going to build up your forearm, and as your forearm builds up, you're going to start hearing clicks. You're going to start hearing clicks in your wrist, especially like with me, I have tight wrists, and you'll start hearing clicks. There it is. There we go. I can actually do it this way. I can actually get the click. There we go.
Is that normal? Here's a click.
It's normal if you're going to learn Kung Fu. I mean, you know, you got to understand, this kind of training is not only for a stick, this is actually for the different wrist locks, because you have to have really strong wrists. Okay, if you learn wrist locks and you don't have a strong wrist, you know, you're not going to get very far. You know what I'm saying? People don't understand that. And if you already notice, in all the guidance of Kung Fu, you know, even the stuff, the other stuff we do, there's a lot of wrist movement, you know? You get confused like everybody. So don't feel bad about it, you know, that when I first started, people would just laugh at me when I said, yeah. And that's embarrassing when you hit yourself. That is so fucked up. Or if you start going a little faster and then all of a sudden you punk yourself on the head. That's so stupid. You know? Well, when you're in the studio, see, if over here there's nobody looking, so it doesn't matter. But when you're in the studio and you do that, you're like, oh my God, I can't even fight this. I'm just hopeful I ordered some washers because they are so fucking expensive. Actually, the thing is, they're more expensive than quarters, 28 cents a piece. So, well, I got carried away. I actually ordered $6 worth. You know, I went to Amazon, and then the thing is yeah, well, $636 for $100, but it could mean that I can do a lot of experimentation. All right, because we originally used the washers just so we wouldn't break the end. You know, the ends. We would actually put the washer and then tape it so we wouldn't break the. It was wood.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so we didn't break. Okay, all this is different now because later on they used to just cover it up, and then okay, I actually did the same what they did at the studio. We would get the tennis balls and put them on.
Oh.
You know, so we didn't. Okay, so beginners wouldn't be hitting things, and then the thing is then. Later on, some people got the right idea of putting these rubber things. And believe it or not, I actually saw this video a couple days ago. The people who do batons do the same thing. I mean, instead of spending $60 to $200, I didn't know those. Batons can be up to $200. You know, where the girls do those.
Oh, really?
Do yeah. Those things.
Right.
$200. Damn! So anyway, they use two balls, you know, tennis balls.
Did that baton thing originally come from martial arts?
You know, I don't know, but we've seen it for so many years, and they do all kinds of tricks. But they do a lot of similar stuff. When, you know, when I start learning the stick, I'm going, I thought the same thing. I go, I see that in football. Well, I saw it mostly in football, you know?
Oh, yeah.
When they, you know, halftime or the beginning, they, you know, the and the cheerleaders. Do all that stuff. And I'm like, wow. And now I looked it up, and then the thing is, they do the same thing for a different reason. They do it to put, you know, the batons have little weights on them, and actually you can adjust, which we can't, but they make adjustments on the weight. So each person, you know, they find the right weight and how they can swing it better. I'm not trying to do that. I'm just trying to put a little bit more weight into everything. Okay. Now, so you did that, let's see the mambo. That's too big, okay. You don't want to have, okay. All right, here's the thing. I think I told you. Okay, my mambo is way too small because of the fighting stance. But the thing is, I'm getting older, I'm tight. But the thing is what you want to do is a moderate, every so often you do a wide, I think I told you. Wide is to really stretch you out. But you want a medium. The correct, the best way is a smaller one, that's the fighting stance. But the thing is, you want a medium for overall development, but you don't want to go too wide. There are some, okay, especially boxing cholifa, they believe in doing wide from the very beginning, but they have the feet put out there. They lose power by spraying their feet, you know, their knees and the toes. Slightly face outward, you could move faster, but you lose strength. If you have it squared, it's much more solid.
So do they do this?
You can do that. Okay, that's a hunga. That's hunga. Oh, yeah, that's one, two, three, and then yeah, stretch. Okay, we don't do that. We just step out. But you can do if do what you want if that feels good for you. People used to always ask Sifu that. They go, oh, you see a movie, huh? He was funny. Oh, you see a movie, huh? You know? And he would never say Hunga. Never.
Uh-huh.
Okay, because, well, that's our sister style. Let's call our sister.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, Hunga and Cholifoot are called sister style. It means they're... No, they get along very. All it means is we get along very well.
Wow.
That's all it means. The thing is, we have similar, you know, similar concepts. We've never had any fights with each other. A lot of people who learn Hunga later learn Cholifa, just like Professor Lao Bud. He actually, when he was 12, he actually learned Hunga, and then later on, when he was 16, he started doing Cholifa. But there's a lot of people who've learned. Or Hunga people that learned a little Cholifa too, so. Okay. Let's start from the beginning, okay? Okay, look at, when you're here. No, just stay over here so you can see. I just want you to see first. Okay, when you're here, you turn, the body turns, okay? now you're in the gentle horse. See how I do this? You turn, step, gentle. Okay? Step, turn. Okay? Step, turn. Back. Step, turn. Okay? It's very important. Why do you think it's that way? No, you always have to see what you're doing. Okay? You always have to. Two more and then add an extra T. If I had time, I did, which I did not have. I've been so busy getting almost nothing done.
So on this side, say we could do a double?
No, the third one would do a double T. That's what we call it. We go a left T and then, right T and then a left T. We do not call it bow and arrow stance. We have our own terminology. No, you really have to step out and slide. The back leg has to slide. Yeah.
Okay.
No, the back leg slides. The first front leg steps. Okay, when you look, you step in, or you can go sideways, but you still got to look. But the back leg slides a little bit. Now, see, that's not sliding. There has to be a slight slide, so you have to step. No, it just slides. You're from here, okay? You turn and look, and you take a step. See how
much? I see. Oh, okay.
Hey.
Yeah, that's almost like a wind gun.
Okay?
Yeah.
So you're working both. Okay.
Yeah,
I see. You gotta work both things. Nothing is free in chili flakes.
Okay.
You asked for it. Okay? See, it's different.
I thought you were supposed to slide and do this at the same time. But I get it now. So,
yeah, there you go. Don't come up too high here when you come back,
okay.
Which is a bad habit everyone has. Even I have a little dip, and you want to keep it even the whole way. But you're already getting into that habit that all of us get into. Yeah, try to do it all with your legs. Okay, now that you've got the general idea, when you're moving into a T, all your lower body, you know, from your waist down, turns into the, you grind into the ground. Okay, you've got the general idea now.
Okay.
So now what you want to try to do is grind into the ground when you do a T.
Okay.
And I'll explain. Okay. Same, yeah, the front leg has to stay the same thing.
What really bugs that? Pull it up.
Yeah. No, it actually it's a defense.
Oh, it's a defense.
Have you ever noticed when I do things to you, I always step into you? You never notice that. When I do things, even Tai Chi, I actually step in.
Uh-huh.
That's what you're learning how to do, is step in, and you have to defend. Okay, your biggest weakness spot is your, shin. So you gotta protect your shin. That's why we have it that way, and it's sort of bent, so even if they kick here, this bends forward that way. So the thing is, even if they give you, the way to attack that is to give a kick to the shin or give a kick to the back of the leg. By actually doing the T, you're actually defending against both of those. Because if they give you the kick, your knee will go forward. It won't be in a contract. If you were in a bow and arrow, then the thing is your leg can only, if you did a bow and arrow and you get kicked, your leg will go forward.
Yeah.
Your body will go forward. So the idea is we do it slanted. So the thing is the knee will go forward that way. Okay. If we get kicked. All right. So then using that momentum, we act, which you don't know yet. But the thing is there's a crossover. There's a crossover we do, and that's our defense against the leg shot. Okay? Not that we can do it, because you gotta be real quick. I mean, the person, usually a kicker, is gonna be really, usually kickers are good.
So then this stance here is not a front, it's a weight.
It actually, it is still even, but the thing is there's an emphasis, and I'm repeating the word emphasis, on a slightly forward of the front leg. There's a forward position, but it should be even. This is not, but the back leg is not locked. It should be straight and not locked.
Oh, straight and not locked.
Yeah. No lock at all, because you have to be flexible, okay? The thing that people don't understand, they always talk about chili foot horse. You know, they always talk about chili foot horse and everything, but they don't realize we train ourselves to have a super flexible horse. You know, we're not like Hunga that I mean. And Hunga, you ain't gonna not, if a good, you meet a good Hunga person with their horse, they're really strong. But a lot of times they can't move as fast, okay? Because they don't have, unless, you know, they have years, and then they'll have a flexible horse. We try to have a flexible horse from the very beginning. Imagine you're stepping, when you're doing that, when you step in, imagine that you're charging into someone.
So I gotta stay that way.
Yeah, but you turn. As soon as you step, you turn.
Oh,
you see how I did it?
As soon as I'm in there, I turn.
Yeah. Okay. You have to see where you go.
Yeah, that really loads that leg up.
Yep.
Really. And That's got to be straight but not clogged.
Yep.
Sunk.
But relax, you gotta really, you know, I know everyone gets like this and they get their shoulders up. It has to be low. You have really sink it, everything. It's hard at the beginning. In fact, I'm doing a little bit every so often. See how this takes
both,
longer?
The both of them.
Yeah.
So, both loaded. You know, we got multiple.